Want me here?
Sure. Okay.
Good evening. My name is Tony Zondi, and I'm a proud graduate of this university, and I graduated in 1976. I also sit on the board of directors for the Center for the Study of Free Enterprise. It's my pleasure to welcome all the students, the faculty, and the community to the speaker series, and I would like also to recognize our interim chancellor, Allison Morrison Shelter, and acting provost, Carol Burton, as well as three members of the board with the Center of the Study of Free Enterprise, Pam Fry, Ken Torek, and Phil Walker. This fireside chat with Ken Langone and moderated by Ed Lopez is part of the Western Carolina University Distinguished Speaker Series. The speaker series are co-sponsored by the Office of the Provost and the Center for the Study of Free Enterprise. The speaker series is designed to bring to campus unique perspectives from national leaders in business, politics, the arts, and more, giving the campus and the community the opportunity to hear from the influential voices in America. If you want to learn more about the speaker series and the Center for the Study of Free Enterprise, you can go to the website enterprise.wcu.edu. And I am pleased to introduce Ken Langone. It was a short 2 months ago in July that I was at a club in the southern part of the county, and Ken was doing a book talk. I approached him and asked him to come talk to the student body here, and he graciously and immediately said yes. As I have read Ken's book, I notice that we have some similarities. One, we both have an Italian heritage. Two, we both acknowledge that we have wonderful wives, and without them, we would not be the success we are. Three, we both went to universities that have animals as mascots. Ken is a graduate of Bucknell, and of course they are the Bisons. I'm here, and of course we are the Catamounts. The other thing of similarity is Ken co-founded Home Depot. I love to shop Home Depot. Ken is a billionaire. Unfortunately, that's where the similarities stop. Let's give Ken a warm welcome. Thank you, Ken.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's a great honor to be here.
Thank you so much, Tony, for that introduction. Thank you, everybody, for joining us here this evening. And thanks to those who are joining us on our live stream of WCU's Facebook Live. Ken, welcome to Western Carolina University, home of the Catamounts. Yeah. We're very excited to have you here tonight, and with your wife, Elaine, as well.
My bride of 62 years is here with me.
Welcome, Elaine.
We do everything together.
So I have a copy of your book here handy for us to reference if we need to, look up in the index if we have to. But I wanted to ask you first about the author, Ken Langone. You come from humble beginnings. You've worked your way up. You are here before us today as a success in business, a success in philanthropy. How did all that happen? Who is Ken Langone?
Well, I think I'm probably the same as most kids that go to the school. My story only could happen because I had the good fortune to be born in America. So a lot of what good things have happened to me only happened because my grandparents saw a better life here in this country. And in this period of time now where everybody's beside themselves about immigrants, we're a nation of immigrants. And I just think that they came through an orderly process. They did what they had to do, and they came into the country, and they were contributing members of society. I don't have any trouble with us as a nation, but I do believe you need a process. But what's the sense of having board? But anyway, what about me? I always like to make money. And maybe that's a sin, but if it is, then I plead guilty. And every once in a while, I talk to a group that I suspect is more liberal than this group is here. One time I was talking to a group like that, and somebody mentioned to me the fact that money doesn't buy everything. And I said, well, try poverty, see how good it does. And so we can do a whole lot more for others as well as for ourselves if we have success. And how does that success come? Hard work, luck, a lot of luck. I'd rather be lucky than smart, frankly. The ability to bounce back from an adverse circumstance in your life. And common sense. Look at a business and ask yourself the question, if I go into this business, am I going to be doing something that somebody's willing to buy from me or a service that somebody's willing to pay me for? And most businesses fail because the analysis of the opportunity is flawed before they even start, but they go ahead and do it. So it's destined to. We had a very simple belief with Home Depot. We saw the prices that were prevalent in hardware stores across America, and they were inordinately high. They had very big margins. They were smallish, and in many respects, they didn't carry basics. They didn't carry lumber, or they didn't carry paint. Things that are the most biggest single reason somebody comes into a Home Depot to shop is for paint. And that's why the paint desk is always in the front of the store. So we understood the market opportunity, and we just made our minds up there was going to be three parts that was going to work for us. One, first and foremost, was the people that worked with us, not for us. We have a mindset that people don't work for us, people work with us. So our employees, we affectionately call associates, because we want them to think like they're an owner. And indeed, the day you come to work for Home Depot, the very day you come to work for Home Depot, you're a stockholder of the company. You're an owner, and from there on, you're on your way. So number one was the quality and the commitment of the people to give you a great experience. Number two, price. We wanted to be sure that people said, wow, this is a good deal, I'm going to come here. And the last part of the exercise was assortment. If you wanted a $30 faucet, we have it. If you want a $200 faucet, we have it. If you want a $3 can of paint, we have it. If you want a $25 can of paint. So the idea was to give the customer the choice based on an informed workforce, our partners, our people that work for us, that you could walk into a store and ask a question, and they would be able to help you through whatever you're trying to do. And the thing we always told, and I, by the way, see vernacular, I'm 83, so anybody under 83 is a kid. So when I talk about kids, that means anybody less than 83. And we always tell the kids, never sell the customer more than they want or than what they need. And if there's an item in the store that's cheaper than another item but does the job just as good for the customer, then you take the customer to that product. Because that's how you build trust. And a story I love to tell is, and this is, gives you some idea of goodwill. We had a young man working in one of our stores on Long Island. And a man came in on a Saturday morning with a stem. This is the workings of a faucet that if you take it apart, at the bottom of it there's a washer. And when you have your handle, it turns that stem, which turns the water on and off. When the washer is broken or brittle, water gets through and you get a drip. And I guess this guy's wife got tired of the drips at 3 o'clock in the morning, and he was tired of being kicked to get up and turn the faucet. And so he shows up this Saturday morning with his stem. And he says to this young man, I need a new one of these. And the kid looked at him and he said, you don't need a new one of those. He said, come on with me. So he took him over to the plumbing department. And we have little bags, plastic bags, of assorted size washers, about 30 cents or 35 cents. He takes it off the peg. He opens it up and he picks out the right size faucet. He unscrews, he's got a little screwdriver in his apron. He unscrews the screw, t- takes out the old washer, puts the new washer in, puts the screw back in, and said, here, take it home. It won't drip anymore. And the guy said, what do I owe you? You owe me nothing. Fast forward 3 months. The wife and the husband have now decided they need a new kitchen. And the wife wants to go to one of these foo-foo places where you spend a lot of money. And the husband said, oh, no, I'm going back to my friend at Home Depot. They bought an $80,000 kitchen because this boy gave them a 3-cent washer. That's called goodwill. And that's what we impress on our people in our stores. We'd rather have the customer leave knowing they were well served as opposed to feeling they were forced, something forced on them. And the key to the company is and always will be the people. They're precious. We have over 400,000 of them. And it's capitalism at its very best. The thing that I'm proudest of, by the way, I don't know how much I'm worth. People say I'm worth that, and it's okay, but in my book I mentioned when I was a kid and I played poker, I used to love to play poker. Every time I counted the money in front of me before the game was over, I ended up losing. So I'm still playing the game and I'm not counting because I'm afraid if I count, the same thing will happen. But we have 3,000 kids that started in the parking lot. That's entry level. Barely out of high school. These are kids that didn't go to college for one reason or another, didn't want to, weren't college material, you name it, whatever it is. They're multimillionaires today. The woman that runs the 1,700 U.S. stores in America, we have 1,700 here in America, and we got another couple of hundred in Canada and another 150 in Mexico, and we have stores in Guam, Puerto Rico, Virgin Islands. The lady that runs these 1,700 stores, which has got 340,000 associates, started with us as a part-time cashier 33 years ago. Mm-hmm. And she's fabulous. She's not good, she's spectacular. Her name is Anna Marie Campbell. She's from Jamaica, originally from Jamaica. She's got a passion for our people like nothing I've ever seen. And for that reason, the motivation of these young people and all the people in the store to do the very best they can, it works. And I want to tell you, I've always said about this school, not knowing anything about it, that this is the place where I want to hire and recruit a lot of kids, because for the most part, they are hungry, they want to work hard, and I think they'll be happy in whatever they do, and that's very important.
That's great. So I feel like as a homeowner, I have the co-founder of
Home Depot. Well, by the way, you assured me, you promised me that everybody that was here tonight will only shop at Home Depot from now on. That was the deal, okay?
Can you press pause on the camera, please? But as a homeowner, I've got the co-founder of Home Depot here. I feel like I should ask some DIY tips, but
I might know some, and some I don't.
You know, you seem to know your way around a faucet pretty well. So,
my father was a plumber.
Yeah, and I remember this, reading that in the book. Let me ask you this, because we do have so many young people, so many students here in the audience, and I think that they have a lot of drive, they have a lot of talent, they have a lot of ambition. But you have a lot of experience. So I was wondering if you could maybe impart some of your thoughts on doing business. In particular, you write in the book, one of your core values is under-promise and over-deliver. What do you mean by that?
Well, always make sure you give more than is expected of you. There's another thing. Don't take a job just because of the money. That should be the very last reason that you take a job. The very first reason you should take a job is because you're going to love what you're doing. And I tell people, the acid test, now this is not practical, but if you had to pay to go to work, that you would love your work so much that you would pay if you could to go to that job. Because the happier and the more satisfied you are, the more likely. I'm looking over here because I see it seems to be more kids over in this part of the room. I don't know if that's by design or not. So if you're over there too, please, I don't mean to offend you, but please, love your work. I can't think of a day in my life that I really didn't look forward to going to work and doing what I was doing. Even when I was 16 years old and working as a day laborer when they were building the Long Island Expressway. And the reason for that love was I was getting $2.50 an hour there versus $1 an hour cutting lawns. So I'd have let them put me in chains for $2.50 an hour. But love what you're doing. And if the day you wake up and you say, oh, I got to go to that job again, start looking, because you will not be successful. People typically perform better when they find themselves doing something they love doing. And one of the current things I'm involved in right now and I'm passionate about is trades. I commend you kids for all being here and working like hell and doing it, giving it your best. But college is not for everybody. And in New York City, a plumber or a carpenter makes about $125,000 a year. Okay? And there's a shortage for them. Okay? I'm not saying about the money, but I can tell you right now, my dad was a plumber. He loved being a plumber. He was a terrible businessman, but he loved being a plumber. And he was a great plumber, not a good one. He was a great one because he loved it. I love what I'm doing. There's no amount of effort on my part to do what I do because I love what I'm doing. So I plead with you, don't go to a job where, oh my God, I got to go there again, or oh, I don't like my boss. Now, if you like your work and you don't like your boss, that's okay, because you're doing something you like and you'll win them over. Because if you're there and you're doing what you like, the likelihood is you'll do much better and you'll stand out. So that would be my single biggest. Too many kids today, and for example, the rage over the last 20 years was financial services, where every kid wanted to go to Wall Street and work because the streets were paved with gold. Guess what? It isn't gold anymore, and it's not even brass. But the point is, that's the wrong reason to go to work. Now, we all have to have a job. Sometimes we have to take a job because there's nothing else, and I don't want to leave the area. There's a lot of circumstances. But to the extent that you have a chance to doing something you're going to love doing every day, well, it's not work. It's not work. But you'll do well at it because you love what you're doing. And as I said, the more you love what you're doing, the better you'll do. And the better you'll do, the more valuable you become to yourself or to the organization you're with.
It takes a little judgment to follow through on that sage advice. Many of the stories that you tell of your success along the way involve having to make a judgment call, sometimes having to make a judgment call on the spot. How did you develop your sense of judgment, and what kind of lesson could you impart on others?
Well, don't give me too much credit for good judgment, because if you got about 6 months, I can tell you about all the stupid things I did. And I mean that. You know, my career is not without bumps on the road. The first thing I will tell you is there's only one thing that matters in terms of judgment, and that's your reputation. The first thing you walk away from is something where you know it's wrong, ethically or in terms of your values or morally. Get away from it. Get away quick. And if you're in an environment where you have to compromise your values, quit, because you're going to pay the highest price. Warren Buffett has a wonderful expression. It takes a lifetime to build a reputation, and you can lose it in 5 minutes. Okay? So you hold dearly to your values, and you, look, sometimes being truthful is not beneficial to your own interest, but over the long term, it will stand you in good stead if you adhere to the fundamental principle of somebody can count on you for what the facts are and what reality is. And as I said, so judgment, what do they say? Judgment comes from bad experiences, and bad experiences come from good judgment. So it's circular. And all I would urge you is, you're gonna make mistakes. Don't let them be mistakes of character or integrity or values. It's that simple. Any other mistake, you'll recover from. You can recover from. But about matters of those nature, it's unforgiving, and it should be. And so a judgment, I will tell you this, and I use the example of Sam Walton. Sam Walton had four little Ben Franklin five and dime stores in northwestern Arkansas, Bentonville. And he heard about a store that had just opened up in Michigan. It was opened by a company called S.S. Kresge, a five and dime chain. And the store they opened was called Kmart. And Sam went up to see it and decided that's the future of retailing. Kmart was staggeringly bigger than Walmart was, or the Ben Franklin stores. Sam went back, got out of the Ben Franklin business, opened up Walmart. Walmart today is the largest corporation by revenues in the world. Kmart went bankrupt. The difference? People. It's that simple. People. I can't tell you how to measure people, but I can tell you right now, I look for little nuances in people. One of the things, speaking of judgment, that I love to do if I'm interviewing somebody for a business or a job, I love to have a meal with them. And I love to watch how they treat the waiter or the busboy or whoever. And you'd be amazed at the insight you'll get to the sensitivity and the kindness of people. Because I do believe they interchange here. Kindness is not accidental. Kindness is an effort on the part of one person to do something for another person, particularly that's least expected. So there's judgment. And you can't teach people to be sensitive. They either are or they aren't. And if they are, then they'll know how to motivate people. The trick in business is how do I get each of you as my partner working with me for a common purpose or a common goal? That's been the secret sauce of Home Depot, is to get all these people in the stores to buy into the notion of what we believed in, which was that the customer comes to us for a fair deal, the customer comes to us for knowledge, and the customer comes to us because it's fun to be in our store. And we treat them like we like having them there. This is simple stuff. But you got to work at it all the time. And you got to be sincere about it. You got to make damn sure that that's not just an act on your part, that that's the way you are and that's what you mean.
Right, I think that if you look at capitalism, I think what you're saying is capitalism needs losses as much as it needs profits as a system in order to sustain.
That's the capitalistic system. There's not everybody wins. There's winners and losers.
Right. And you think about Kmart at one point being the wave of the future. Well, now we have bankruptcies like Sears.
Sears is another one. We had Kodak. Sears was the store in America after World War II. It was the store. Mm-hmm. There was a book written about it called The Big Store. I mean, you go right down the list of all these companies that once were. What happened to them? People. Leadership. Example. Somebody from this university one day, mark my word, will be a significant higher up in some major company in America. I have no doubt about it. And I could say that about most schools like this, where the kids come here wanting a better life and willing to sacrifice and willing to make the effort. And I'm passionate about this kind of an environment because that's what I came from. Now, don't do everything I did because you might find yourself a little disappointed. But I can only urge you that the human element, the human condition is alive and well, and it's precious in a business setting. Very important. Nothing more, nothing less. You say, that's pretty simple stuff. Yeah, it is pretty simple stuff, but it works. But it requires an effort. And it requires the commitment to do right by the other person. I've done a lot of business transactions called deals. I always am very comfortable if the other guy feels he got a better deal than I did. As long as I feel I got the deal that makes me, the win-win is when I feel like I got a great deal and he thinks he got a better deal. I can live on, you know, this is not about ego. This is about wanting a guy to come back and do another deal with you. And in the book, I mentioned the story about I negotiated pretty hard on a deal. And we worked late at night and got the deal done. And the next morning, the fellow that I made the deal with, I said, well, how are you feeling? He said, well, I says, I really think I could have had a better deal. I said, what do you mean? I said, we went over everything. We negotiated. And I said, I thought at the end of the night you were pretty satisfied. He said, no, no, no. He said, I thought about it. I said, well, okay. Tell me what you think you should have. And he told me. And I said to him, okay, you got it. Everything, I said, everything you want. That's it? I said, that's it. I said, but I never want to do business with you again. Okay? If you can't deal in good faith, let me start by saying one thing that I think resonates, probably will resonate in this room. If I were teaching here, and the school said I could only have one book for my students to read, guess what I'd tell them to read? I'd tell them to read the Bible. Virtually every good business principle is in the Bible. Do unto others as you would have others do unto yourself, the golden rule. All the basic tenets. I was blessed to miss doing business with a man by the name of Bernie Madoff. He thought he had me. I mean, really, I guess he thought I was born last night. Well, I was, but I was born at night, but not last night. And I'll tell you how I ducked it. He was pitching me. I'd never done business with him. He was pitching me that he was going to give me a deal instead of giving it to all these people that were clients of his for 30 or 40 years. And I thought to myself, wait a minute. How would I like it if I were them? And they found out, and I then found out, that he gave another deal to somebody who he had just met. Well, it turned out it was no deal, it was a scam. And but my motive was very simple. I wouldn't like to have it happen to me. Do unto others as you would have others do unto you. So I'm not here to preach religion, although I will tell you, I am deeply religious, and my faith is a critical part of my life, my family, my faith. That's it. But I can tell you right now, you won't go very far astray. Forget about the religion part of it. But to take heed to the lessons that are in that book and live them, you will not go far from wrong. You'll be pretty good. You'll do very, very good.
Okay? You mentioned being a passionate guy earlier, and I think there's quite a bit of passion in the book. You know, there's a lot of F words in the book, actually. I don't know.
Well, let me say this to you. I apologize. In fact, I'll tell you all a funny story. Yeah. I worked in construction, and I worked in a trading room. And unfortunately, that's the language they use. My publisher, Random House, called me up when the book was being done. And in the back of the book, they have what they call blurbs. People write. They try to get people that are well-known. So Adrian Zakheim from Random House called me up and he said, do you suppose you might get the Cardinal to write a blurb? Mm-hmm. The Cardinal and I are very good friends. And I said, yeah, I think I can. So I called him up and I said, Your Eminence, I've written this book and Random House would like it if you would write a blurb. What do you mean? I thought it's in the back of the book, how you feel about the book and, you know, a positive statement about the book. He said, well, I haven't seen the book. Can you send me the book? I said, what do you need to see the book for? And he said to me, I think I've heard all those words. Send me the book. But, you know, the book is the way it happened. Yeah. Okay? Yeah. Good or bad.
Well, I don't know if Elaine has a swear jar for you at home or not.
No.
I also
if she did, she'd need a 50-gallon jug.
It'd be a big one. Well, you know, I also noticed some other F words, not the F bomb F word, but I wonder if you could give me your reaction to some of the F words that I noticed.
Like,
you mentioned faith a moment ago, mm-hmm. Like friends, like freedom, like failure. Some of those are F words that stood out to me. Family as well. How important are those?
Family, I was saying to my wife this morning after one of our sons called us bright and early to talk to us, I was saying to her about how blessed we are to have the family we have right now. So, you know, it's precious. Failure. I had a partner one time, and I had made a blunder, a bad blunder on a deal. Big time, bad blunder. And he came into my office, and I said, boy, I think I might have blown the place up. He said, what do you mean? I said, I did a terrible, I made a bad mistake. He left the room, and he came back in, and he said, you know, he said, I've been thinking, I don't think I've ever made a mistake. So I thought about it, and I thought about it, and I went back in his office, and I said, you know, I'll clean it up. I said, you know, I said, I believe you. You probably didn't make a mistake. You haven't done a GD thing in your life. So how the hell can you make a, how can you make a mistake? The magic of mistakes should be learning from it. It's okay to make a mistake, but when you make the same mistake twice doing the same thing, that's known as being stupid. Learn from your mistakes. It's okay to make mistakes as long as it's not mistakes of character or integrity or values. It's that simple. You know, people grow through failure. I can only assure you that whatever success I've had, and I leave that for others to judge, whatever success I've had came in good part by learning from what I did before that was a mistake or an error in judgment or whatever it was. And you gotta make mistakes. And the ones that win, the people, Elaine reminded me last night, Jesse Haddock, a great golf coach at Wake Forest, said to Elaine one time, the kids he knows that have got championship potential are the ones that can have a bad hole and snap right back in the next hole and do very well. You know, it's a cruel world out there, and it's a tough world. So that's failure. Faith, family, faith. Faith is precious to me. Okay, I will not proselytize anybody, but on the other hand, accept the fact that I'm absolutely convinced that I'm here tonight with this lovely woman I've had with me for 64 years and the family that I have because it was all a gift from God, and I believe that. And if you want to think there's something wrong in my spiritual belief, that's your right. But I know it stood me in good stead these 83 years, and I'm blessed for it. So. And what was the other F?
Freedom.
Freedom.
Friends.
Freedom. Freedom. We live in the greatest country on earth. Greatest. There'll never be another America. This flag, God is my witness. My grandfather, my mother's father, my grandfather came over here. He was married, and he had two children in Italy. He left his wife and two children. He came to America and shared a room with 11 other men on Mulberry Street in New York to save enough money to send for his wife and his two children. When I put this flag on every day, I think, Grandma and Grandpa, thanks for coming to America. Because I'm absolutely convinced, and don't you ever forget this, all this nonsense you hear from these politicians telling us how bad we are and how wrong it is and this and that and the other thing, there's no place on this earth. Why do you suppose 7,000 people are doing what they're doing? They're not doing it to go to Hungary. They're not doing it to go to France. They're doing it because they want to come here. Well, there must be something special about here. There is never going to be another America as long as we live. And we ought to feel blessed for that. And this freedom that we have, this freedom that you can be whatever you want to be. If you want it, you got to work hard for it. But you couldn't do it. I insisted in the book, my original title was going to be Capitalism and Me, a Love Affair. Thank God the publishers had more sense. I love capitalism is much better. But I insisted that part of the title be An American Story, because it wouldn't have happened. Wouldn't have happened in Italy. My grandfather left. My grandfather left school when he was 6 years old. And he came over here and worked with a shovel his whole entire life until he died. But boy, was he a proud American. The most happy day in his life. There's an organization called Sons of Italy. And it's typically, it's made up of immigrants and children of immigrants that were of Italian extraction. And they have these lodges. It's like the Elks Lodge and the Moose and all these Kiwanis and stuff. And that, and the most, I've got a picture of them in my office. On Memorial Day, the sons, the order, his lodge marched in the Memorial Day parade every year. And that was my grandfather's big day. He just loved America. And I think the minute we all take a step back and thank God for this great country, we're all going to be better off. And frankly, if somebody doesn't like it, get the hell out of here. You know, go wherever you want. Just get out of here. There's no, remember this. You have a chance only in America to do and be what you want. So I go on forever about America, okay?
Well, you must have had a lot of fun writing this book.
I did.
And, you know, one thing I'm curious about, because there's so many interesting stories about extensive dealings that you had with such high-profile people like Ross Perot, like Jack Welch, like Elliot Spitzer.
My buddy.
You mentioned Bernie Madoff. And also organizations that are household names, you know, Home Depot, NYU, Ronald McDonald House, and so forth. As you were writing the book, was there a story that came along, or maybe more, that you rediscovered as a process of writing the book and that you became fond of?
I'll tell you something interesting. What it, and I said in the book, I've got a good memory. In fact, let me tell you about Italian Alzheimer's. We forget everything but the grudge. Okay. But the thing that was really refreshing and rewarding to me was as I began to think and put it together, all of a sudden facts came back to me that I don't know where the hell they came from. And I'll give you this just happened a week ago. In the book, I wrote about how I got this job as a day laborer building the expressway for $2.50 an hour, and I had to join a union. And I don't know how I happen to remember the local number. It was Labor Union Local 1298. And I wrote in the book that I joined this union, and I was, because of that, I was able to get, so you see, I benefited by being a union member. I'm not opposed to unions, not at all. Unions, if they do the right thing for their people, are fine, but let people decide whether they want to be in a union or not. That's, to me, the fundamental difference. Anyway, so about a week and a half after the book came out, I get a letter from the president of Local 1298 telling me that somebody told him he should read the book, and he read the book, and he saw I said I was a member, and he went into their archives, and he found my two applications, one from 1954 and one from 1955, that's 64 years ago. And he said that, apropos your remark, he said that he would give me the originals if I came out and would speak to the local. And he then said in the book, in the letter, he said, yeah, and he's like, I guess you're probably the only guy that's ever been a member of our union that's a billionaire. So I went and spoke a week ago last Wednesday night. And I want to tell you what moved me. Now, these are all, we're talking about bad language. These are all rough as a cob, these guys are. They're all, and by the way, you'd be amazed the number of women that are now in the local union, because they now bring in women, a lot of them do a lot of different things in the union, flagmen and stuff like that. And so here it was, 6:30 on a Wednesday night. And the first thing they did, which blew me away, first thing they did, there's a flag up on the stage. They all stood up and said the Pledge of Allegiance. And you know what? Boy, am I glad I was a member of that union. And I talked to these people. And it was a wonderful experience for me. And I reflected back, talked back to the book. I reflected back on those 2 years making that money. And one of the goals I had for the 1 year was to buy Elaine an engagement ring, because we got engaged in 1955. And so the book was a wonderful experience, and thank God I have a good memory. Sometimes it's not so good. Sometimes you wish you'd forget things you remember, okay? But But it was a wonderful experience, and I'm glad I did it. And I'm never going to write another book. Okay, I've written one. And
there are critics of capitalism. Mm-hmm. And a big criticism of capitalism, there are quite a few. I mean, it's not equal. It leads to terrible inequalities. There are ways of mm-hmm. Channeling that people can channel greed, that it favors greed in the human condition. It makes us materialistic. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the biggest critics on that margin is the Holy Father, Pope Francis.
And he and I have had our differences.
Right. And right. So how do you...
That gives me a problem with my faith. I want you to know that.
Some conversations...
I want him praying for me when I'm gone. Yeah. That's saying I'm glad he's gone.
Some conversations I'd like to be a fly on the wall for. I'm not sure that
one
counts.
Let me tell you about capitalism.
How do you answer that?
Let me tell you about capitalism. Mm-hmm. I want you to think of all of the hospitals and museums and schools and athletic facilities and gyms that has somebody's name on. I don't believe it's my right to tell anybody else what to do with their money. But thank God Elaine and I have a very strong sense of obligation to give back. I'll only give you one number I'm sure I'm right about. Elaine and I have given away far more money to great causes than we've spent on ourselves from the day we got married. I couldn't do that. My father would love to have had his name on a building at Bucknell, but he couldn't afford it. But I could, and I did. And those kids that go up there and use that building, I pray to God they're better students, and I pray to God they have a good experience there, and I pray to God they recognize that if they are successful, one way or another they give back. I would rather be remembered, not for the money we've given away, because very frankly, we've sacrificed nothing in giving the money away. But the time Elaine spends with the Boys Club in New York, or the Animal Medical Center in New York, and me at my medical center, NYU, our medical center, I should say, with Bucknell, I'm not going to get that time back. And we have a finite amount of time on this earth. And so when you do something and take time, believe it or not, all the money we've given away, we've made back. Made it all back. Time is gone. So charity or philanthropy takes many forms. The thing I am adamant about, it's not my right to tell anybody else what to do with their money or their time. It's their business. I have no right, and I don't think less or more of them. Okay? I would say this if they asked me. I would say to them, you have no idea the sense of accomplishment Elaine and I feel by doing things and expecting nothing back for it. So I can guarantee you one thing, and it doesn't just have to be money. Go to a hospital and read a story to a child that's ill. Go to a hospital and donate your time to help with a situation where they need help in the hospital. Go to a local effort to clean up a park. There's many different ways you could express your gratitude for what's happened to you. It doesn't just have, fortunately in my case, we can do it with a check as well as with time. But we do it with both because we understand it's our involvement that's far more precious than the check we write. And I think, so these are the things, Ed, when you talk about what matters to us, these are the things that matter to us. Nothing more and nothing less. I mean, I'm on the board of Ronald McDonald House. In New York, biggest Ronald McDonald House in the world. I have over 100 rooms. I don't have many, the good Lord's been good to me. I'm a perennial optimist. I don't have many bad days. But if I had a bad day, all I'd have to do is to go up to that house and see these kids fighting like hell to live one more day. And I know I've got a pretty good day. So these are the payoffs you get by sharing whatever you have with others. And that goes back to the Bible. And remember this, if you're not going to do it cheerfully, don't do it. God loves a cheerful giver. So these are the things that you want to take away. And work like hell. Give it your best shot. But make sure you're going someplace that you want to go to every day and you love doing what you're doing and you can't wait to get there. And if the boss said, you got to pay me to come here and you can afford it, you'd pay him to go there. Because that means you really love it and you're going to be successful.
What else? I think that's great. I think business freedom is civil association.
Well, about the Pope. Let me tell you about the Pope.
Just as important.
The Pope is a nice man, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I had the good fortune to head up the rest. By the way, if any of you get to New York City, I urge you to go visit St. Patrick's Cathedral since the Restoration. Is it nuts? Have you seen it? Is it spectacular? I had the good fortune to head up the restoration of the cathedral. And 3 years ago, the Pope came to New York, and he's walking down the aisle of St. Patrick's Cathedral. He's going to do Vespers at the cathedral. And the Cardinal's walking with him, and he's looking around at this magnificent building, magnificent. And he says to the Cardinal, isn't it wonderful that your government gives you this kind of money to do something like this? And the Cardinal says, Holy Father, he said, it's against the law for our government to give a religious organization 5 cents. And the next day, the very next day, he wanted to see a parochial school, a Catholic school. So we went to see the Catholic school. And again, the Holy Father said, look at this, these kids in these schools in uniforms, this is wonderful, your government. And again, Cardinal Dolan said, Holy Father, he said, we get nothing from our government. And Steve Schwarzman, who's a Jew, by the way, was there. Steve Schwarzman that week had given the schools $42 million, the Catholic schools.
Wow.
And he leaned, he pointed to him and he said, you see that man over there, he's a Jew? He gave us the money for the things you see in this building here. And I'll tell you a great experience for me. Of all the money we raised for St. Patrick's restoration, $200 million, big job. 40% of it came from non-Catholics, and most of them were Jews. So you talk about ecumenicalism, you talk about what a great nation we are, and how we're all one, there it is.
Thank you for sharing your vision there and your rendition of cooperation, and capitalism can be about competition.
Well, and that's brutal, but I give the Pope a pass for one reason. Mm-hmm. He never left Argentina until he became Pope. Argentina is run by 5 families, and so they don't share. If he was here, I think he would understand the essence of what America really is. America is us. America is all the good we do, not just for this country, but for the world. Look at what we did after World War II. We helped our enemies get up on their feet after we lost so many lives to them and their bullets. We had the goodwill and the good fortune to go back and say, we're going to help Germany get on their feet. We're going to help Italy get on. We're going to help Japan get on their feet. We did it. Nobody's ever done that before in the history of war. The conqueror goes in and pillars and takes everything and leaves.
Go ahead. So we have a couple more minutes before we open it up to the floor.
Yep.
I was curious if you have any questions for us here at Western.
How do you make sure, it's a generic, how do you make sure you keep getting kids like you got here? Okay?
Yeah.
I mean this to all you students. This is the kind of place where I have no doubt great kids come from, with humility, hard work, passion, and desire, thank God, to do better than your parents did. That was was easy for me. I wouldn't want to be my son's because my dad was a plumber, he went to the 8th grade, and my mother went to the 7th grade, and she worked in a school cafeteria. It wasn't hard for me to beat. But I keep urging you to make sure you keep getting the same kind of kids you got here, because they're the future of America. They really are, and so don't let up.
Well said. Okay, so thank you. We're going to open it up for some questions, and what I'd like to do is start with some of our students, some of the ones that we've been able to, as you say, Ken, attract here and recruit to Western. It turns out that Western has, in the past year, a student club, Future Business Leaders of America, has been restored in the past year. It was dormant for some time. And it was very much a grassroots and student-led effort. And during last year's academic year, this startup went to the state competitions down in Raleigh and swept the table. And then they went to nationals in Baltimore, national conference. Mm-hmm. Thousands of people there, thousands of competitors, and we had two of our young members of that club place in the first top three. Mm-hmm. So it's a fantastic example of the many fine and thriving student groups that we have on campus. And I think it's my answer to your question.
Okay.
Is mm-hmm. we give the students a good experience here, including their student clubs. So I'd like to invite our chapter president, Lindsay Elias, to pose the first question to you.
Please.
So in your book, your mom said money skips a generation. Do you
I'm sorry, what? Oh, yes. Mom said to me one day, money skips generation, right?
Do you think that if money was in your generation growing up, would you be on a different path than you are today? Would your work ethic have been different, or would you have focused on something else?
No, I think my childhood turned out to be a blessing, big blessing. You know, I think learning to have to think on how to make a buck, I mean, whether it was collecting cardboard at the liquor store or working part-time or selling neckties, selling stationery in college. I mean, you know, one of the great motives in getting things done is wanting something bad enough that you haven't got. You want to work like hell, legitimately, with values, with integrity, and with character. No, I'm absolutely convinced that my origins were extremely helpful to my future career activities. I know this much. I am far more, it's easier for me to relate to going to that labor hall last week and talk to those guys, and I gotta tell you, I felt at home. I mean, they welcomed me, and I really felt like, hey, you know what? These are my guys. And these are the kids at Home Depot. And you know what? You want to turn a kid on? And I tell everybody, there's three most powerful things in life: a kind word, a thoughtful gesture, and passion and enthusiasm for whatever you're doing. When people see you excited and passionate about what you're doing, they're going to say, hey, wait a minute, how do I get some of that? How do I become part of that? So I have no doubt that, for example, my early life had a significant impact on my ability to connect with these kids in our stores. And the same is true with Bernie, and the same is true with Arthur and Pat Farah, the four of us. You know, they felt at home with us because we felt at home with them. So yeah, I have no, that's a good question. I think there's no doubt about it that my early years were a very significant benefit in my later years.
Fantastic. We have a question, I believe, that is coming to us from the written questions from the, or do we have a spoken question? Okay, let's go written, yeah.
So we've got a question here from Colton Greer. Could you describe the relationship needed between IT and finance to effectively operate a business?
Well, beyond IT and finance, it goes to everything you do. The more knowledge you have, the better decision you're going to make. So if IT is a tool that allows finance to have better numbers or quicker numbers, then when you're making decisions that relate to finance, when you're making those decisions, you're far better informed by having IT that knows how to manage getting the information to you and get it to you in a form where you can use it. It's a tool. And the best decisions are informed decisions. And even if you have all the facts, you might still do something wrong, but at least it's a good start to knowing. It's kind of like a map. You know, I'm here and I say, you know what, I want to go to St. Louis. And I start going to where the sun is rising in the morning. I ain't getting to St. Louis from here, okay? So my point is that IT is a critical function and far more important now than ever before, because we're more and more making decisions based on data and based on managed data.
From the floor?
Go ahead.
Yeah, feel free to jump in, folks. Just raise your hand if you have a question.
One over here.
Right there, Kim. Okay.
Hello. Would you share a story about a wrong decision you made or a failure and how you dealt with that?
Oh. As I said, if you got 6 months, I got all kinds of those.
Yeah, it's a hard one.
I was convinced that there was a great future in fish farming and fish catching. And I got so caught up in the science and technology of the effort that what the first thing was going to be, we were going to capture anchovies off the coast of South America, Colombia. And we put these boats down and we raised the money to buy the boats, and we raised the money for the crew and the gas and everything else. And I got a call one night, how are we doing with the anchovies? Well, the anchovies are gone. Where the hell are the anchovies? And they said, well, El Nino is here. What's El Nino? El Nino is a weather pattern that the anchovies go away, okay? Now, so this guy had so enthralled me. He said, but I got a great solution. We're going to go catch langostino off the coast of Western India, where they are in abundance. So that we move the ships from South America all the way across the Pacific Ocean, all the way across the Indian Ocean to the other side of India, only to find out the langostinos were not there, okay? Now, you would think if you're smart enough, after that you've had enough? Uh-uh. We decided, this concerns North Carolina, that you can catch lobsters off the coast of North Carolina. No. The problem is the shells are much thinner, and they don't last as long. Up north, the shells are heavier, and you can keep them longer. Well, guess what? We were looking for abandoned gas stations to sell lobsters that we had to sell because they were going to go bad the next day. Now, what did it tell me? Be careful of fishermen, okay? But, you know, you do stuff like that, and you wish you didn't do it, but you do it.
I married a fisherman, so.
Oh. That's probably why you got such a great smile. Yes, sir.
How about in the back here? I'm sorry, in the back. And the microphone is in the back.
I can hear you good.
No, the microphone is in the back. Sorry, yeah.
I guess everybody else wants to hear you.
Yeah.
The microphone over here. He needs a microphone.
Well, we can go in that order. Next. Yeah. Thank you.
Give him a microphone.
Yeah.
All right, so in your book, you describe a lot of your early entrepreneurial efforts.
Right.
And it's very apparent that you're good at identifying a demand that you can supply. And I was just wondering if you had some sort of methodology or process that you use to kind of figure out what people, a certain people or group, is demanding.
Well, neckties. When I went to college, you had to have a necktie on for every dinner meal. Most kids would either spill everything on the necktie, okay? And here I am driving through New York City on a Sunday night, and there's a place on Times Square called Tie City. I think I was paying about 75 cents a piece. The only problem is after you tie the knot, don't untie it because the wrinkle never comes out. But I knew there was a market for neckties. When I was back at the beginning of my sophomore year, and this was kind of not nice on my part, kids go away to college, their parents drop them off, all their friends are gone someplace else, they're a little homesick and lonely and stuff. And you got to get them that first week. Now, this was intuition. So I get in the freshman dorm with this layout I got of all these different forms of stationery, and I'm sitting there on the edge of the bed with them. And let's see, you got 9 friends. You're going to write to them 3 times a week. That's 27 envelopes, 27 sheets of paper, and you know. Now you got to get them the first. This is a little bit of insight. You got to get them the first week, because by the second week, they've made new friends. They forgot their old friends. I say in the book about the guy that was a senior, when he got me, he swore at me. He said, I got boxes of that stuff yet. And by the way, make sure you get paid in advance, because by the time the stationery comes, they made new friends. I mean, you get insights, okay? Just little, just like when I was talking to the garbage man about what he did with the boxes from the liquor store. And he told me he was selling them. I'm saying, wait a minute, there's a market here. So I went to Lenny Orman, the guy that owned the liquor store, and I said, Lenny, let me keep, I'll break the boxes up. Can I keep them in a pile? And every couple of weeks, and I went down to the scrap dealer, and I got a few bucks. So I think I have a bit of a commercial head. That helps. But I think it's also going back to looking at what people want and need and satisfying that one, not giving them more or less, giving them what they want. So, I mean, it's to me, supply and demand is a pretty simple thing. Just find out where the demand is, find out what they're willing to pay for it, and find out what form they need to get it, and you got a business. I answer your question? Okay. You had a question up here, sir, before they brought you. Oh, you got the mic.
First of all, I want to thank you for coming down the mountain. You've been an absolute delight.
And well, thank you.
And your wisdom
is
just
wonderful.
We love it here. Yeah, that's great. You and I have very similar life histories, except for the money.
But you don't know how much I have, so what do you, I don't know. Come on.
I'm sure. But my parents didn't have money for me to go to college.
Right.
And I went to Lewisburg to go to school.
Because there's a prison there, too, when you say you went to Lewisburg.
Yeah, I went to school. not the penitentiary. And where I knew Martha Henderson and Mal Musser and
you
George
were
Fink.
What year were you?
I was 72.
Oh, you were here. You were 15 years after me.
I was.
Wow.
But at any rate, I got a wonderful education at Bucknell.
So
and,
did I.
And it's been a great thing for me. Oh. But I read last year that Bucknell now has more students from the top 1% than the bottom 50%. How do we change that?
Well, I'll tell you what Elaine and I are doing. We got 38 kids on scholarship at Bucknell right now. Trust me, these kids did not come from the Matterhorn, and they're flying. That's the way I know how to do it. And I do believe, to the university's credit, I was a trustee for 15 years, and now, of course, all my involvement is at the medical center and the university at NYU. But I give them a lot of credit because they're more and more, and this last campaign is for scholarships, because we don't want just rich kids. We want all the, I'm telling you, this is the future of America, okay? Don't kid yourself. I say that from the bottom of my heart. I don't mean anything against Yale or Bucknell or Harvard, but I look at these wonderful schools where these kids are working like hell and they really want, they want to do better, they want a good life, they're willing to make the effort. We need to make sure that all of our colleges have that kind of a mix. And I think Bucknell's making a good effort to do that. And I know for our part, and I go up and once a year I have dinner with these kids, I gotta tell you, it's what a wonderful experience, okay? When you told me Lewisburg, I said, wait, was he up there in the federal pen?
Front row here.
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah. It might be muted.
All right, so while you just said that, like...
That mic is muted, why don't you take James, yeah.
You just said, like, basically there's a very big concentration of wealth and all that. But anyway, so people like me, for instance, or other people with ideas, with the rise of intellectual property theft by, it's global.
By the Chinese principally.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not really global. Most other nations respect each other's intellectual property laws.
So what role do you believe that philanthropy can help mitigate this issue?
It can. Philanthropy can't do it. Government can do it. And by the way, now pardon me, I want to tell you one more thing about those union guys. Everybody says union guys are Democrats, not these guys. I can tell you right now, man. Let me say this to you. China has been allowed to steal our intellectual property forever. I am not pitching Donald Trump tonight. I'm not pitching Donald Trump. I'm stating facts. For 30 years, we've pushed the can down the road. If you and I are doing business, And the deal I have with you, it's a great deal for me, and it's a bad deal for you. I want that deal to go on forever. You want it fixed, okay? Finally, somebody is saying that you here, you got a choice. You can do what we're doing by saying we're going to start putting tariffs in unless you behave. Or you can go to war. That's typically what you did in old times. Well, wars don't work. Finally, somebody's saying to the Chinese, game, set, match. It's time to sit down and make a new deal. This is, to me, the biggest part of the trade problem we have with China is their total lack of regard for not only our intellectual everything American they love. You go over there and you see the Nike swoosh and you see the Under Armour. They got, guess what? Nike didn't make that. Under Armour didn't make that. Some guy in some factory someplace in China is knocking them out and selling them as if they're the real thing. Yeah.
And then even, you might go into litigations that cost even more millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. That's unattainable for somebody like me, somebody that's not wealthy.
Look, in my book, I talk about a man, I thought he was a screwball. He came to see me and he told me that he had invented the laser. Now, I always thought the laser was like sunlight, you know, it's been around forever. Well, guess what? My first reaction to him was, no kidding. Yeah, and the patent office won't give me a patent for it. And I said to him, you know, that's interesting. I invented the wheel and they won't give me a patent on the wheel either. It turns out he was right. He met us and we banked him. Not every guy that has a great creative idea has the good fortune to have, but if you've got something, this is the importance of intellectual property. If you've got something that's the secret sauce, somebody's out there is going to help you. Because guess what? They'll make money off it. We ended up making a bloody fortune by banking Gordon Gould. We banked him. And we ended up, for 17 years, we had 3,000 licensees paying us. We were smart enough not to charge them a lot. Because if you charge a lot, then somebody might challenge the patent. And then you never know. Some creative judge might say, you know what? You should never have the patent, and everything's gone. But there are people, now you gotta understand something. I wish I had a nickel for every idea I saw that I said, get out of here, what are you doing? This is nuts. You know, not every idea, I'm not suggesting what you have is not worth anything, but there are people, there are companies out there that do just this. They bank intellectual property. There's one up in Boston called the Royalty Trust. We at NYU, anybody take Remicade here? Remicade is a drug for rheumatoid arthritis, among other things. We invented it at NYU. We ended up getting $1 billion in royalties and a buyout. There are people out there that will actually bank the litigation for the patent, and then once you got it, they'll buy the patent from you, or they'll give you a piece, you'll sell them a piece of the action on the royalty stream. That's a thriving business today, and that is decidedly American, okay? That's how you do it. More money chasing more good ideas than there are good ideas. Trust me. Yes, ma'am.
We
yes,
have
ma'am.
Time for one more question. One over more here, question. Jane, on your left. It. Over here.
Hi, I'm Jamie Whitfield with the Western Carolinian, and I'm covering your event today. I wanted to know, what are your thoughts about free advanced education, higher education, for anyone who actually wants to go to school as a way to bring more of the lower percentage of the lower income people into our school system and help them prosper?
Okay. I'm going to say something that's going to get me in trouble. I think too many community colleges are a ripoff. Okay? I think anybody that wants an education, we as a society should figure a way out to help them. We can't give it away, but people that want an education bad enough, we should be able to figure a way out to give them some help, but they gotta do their part too. This notion, everything for nothing. You want to know what it leads to? Go to Venezuela. You want to see what socialism is? Go to Cuba. Go to Eastern Europe. Hungary has a declining population. Kids like you kids here in this room that have, that are bright and have a future, once you get an education in Hungary, you beat it. You go someplace else because there's no future there for you. I was blessed. I was blessed with a family that sacrificed for me, and I was blessed with an energy level that allowed me to do what I had to do to get it. I am more respectful of my education because of the effort I had to make. To me, there's a basic tenet in life. Something that you had to work for has so much more value than if something is just given to you. And I believe today in America, there are any number of different ways that kids can get an education. And you don't have to go to Yale or Harvard or Princeton or Dartmouth or those places. In fact, today, I used to have to go to the library on Saturdays when I was working on my master's. I can sit with my iPad today and get all the information I want on anything I want to know about off my Google or off my Yahoo or whatever it is. It's scary how much I have at my fingertips. So I'm all for helping kids that need help, like the kids at Bucknell I'm talking about, but they got to do their part too, because it'll mean so much more to them in the future than if they just say, here, it's for nothing, it's on the house. There's no gain in that. And so that's, I don't know if that's the answer you want, but that's the best one I can give you.
Okay. Not a leading question.
One more.
Well, listen, I would like to.
Somebody's got a question back there.
Okay, we have.
Yeah. I thought he did.
No.
There you go.
Oh yeah. One of my students.
Good.
Yeah. You often mentioned earlier that Walmart got its start by seeing what Kmart did and what other businesses had done before, but thought of ways to make them better. Your corporation and your organization, is there anything you saw that others had done that you decided, we can do the same thing, but we can do it better, we can make it more profitable?
Yeah, well, three things we saw. We saw exceedingly high prices that we thought we could beat. We saw a lack of service. You'd be amazed, you go in the store today, and you wander around, you say, what the hell am I in here for? I don't know where to look, or I don't know what I want. Okay, we saw that. And we also saw people should have choice. If somebody wants a $3 faucet, sell them a $3 faucet. And if somebody's got a magnificent bathroom and they want a $3,000 faucet, give them a $3,000. But let it be their choice. We carry all the name brands, all the name, Black & Decker, Stanley, you name it, we carry them all. Why? If you want that brand, we got it. But if you come over here, I'll show you Rigid, which is a Home Depot house brand, and we'll show you all the features on that that aren't on the Black & Decker or the Stanley. If we had only had ours, you'd say, well, you're only selling me yours because you haven't got the other. We're saying, no, that one's $99.99, and this one is $39.99, and it's got this many more features on it. So we leave it to you. Thank you very much for having me. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Dan, that was wonderful.
Well, thank you for having me.